We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We're coming to Revelation chapter 2. In the series of messages we are listening to, and the Bible teaching that is in the Building with Christ series, we'll be talking about the church. And we're looking at the evolution of the church from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. He had said he would build the church upon the rock, that is, upon himself, upon the truth and the verity and all the cornerstone of the Lord Jesus Christ. And at the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. And so we're looking at this series on the church. We'll be starting to this morning with a fundamental church in a pluralistic world. And then we'll have a fearless church in a persecuting world. After that, a faltering church in a perverted world, and then a feeble church in a putrefying world, a formal church in a perishing world. And then we're going to have tomorrow, by the grace of God, if it tarries to come, we're going to look at a faithful church in a pessimistic world, and then a flattered church in a permissive world. Then we'll round up everything, as he tells us at the end of every message to the churches, about the overcomer. He that overcometh, he that overcometh, he that overcometh, he says that in 7 times to all the 7 churches, and he says it to individuals too, in all the churches. So we'll be looking at overcomers in the promised eternal world. And I pray that you will not miss any of these messages. And then all the other messages that ministers and overseers and pastors will be giving us, we're going to give attention to them in Jesus' name. This morning we come to look at a fundamental church in a pluralistic world. We're looking at Revelation chapter 2. And I'm reading from verse 1. It says, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the 7 stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. It says, I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear with them that are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and has not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast let thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. I pray you'll be an overcomer in Jesus' name. This is a formal church, a fundamental church in the sense that the church believed all the truths of the word of God, and Jesus even commended them for their faith in the Lord. As you look at these 2 chapters, we're going to find in chapters 2 and 3 that Christ was writing to the church. At the beginning of every one, he says, unto the angel of the church, unto the angel of the church, whether it's in Ephesus or Smyrna, or it's writing to Pergamos, or it's writing to Thyatira, or it's writing to Sardis or Philadelphia, or writing to Laodicea, he always begins by to the angel of the church, to the angel of the church. I'm sure you know what the church is. The church is a called out people. Is the ecclesia, is the people that have come, so to say, out of Egypt, and they are on their way to the land of Canaan, to the land of promise. It's the church that came out of the world, and we're on our way to heaven. If you look at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7, you will see here what an illustration of what the church is and what the church ought to be. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7, verse 38. It says, this is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which speak to him in the Mount Sinai, and with our fathers who received the lively oracles to give unto us. As you look at that verse, it says quite a lot. It's talking about Moses there, and it said, this is he. You have all this congregation of the children of Israel. And one thing we know about them is that they came out of, and they were going into, and they were going through. Those words are very important. Number one, out of. Number two, they were going through. Number three, they were going into. They came out of the land of Egypt. And that's like the church. It mentions the church right there. The church in the wilderness. That's the ecclesia of God. In the Old Testament, those are the people that came out of the world. They came out of the idolatry of Egypt. They came out of the practices of Egypt. They came out of all the pollutions of Egypt. They came out of all the system of Egypt. They came out from under the power that dominated, that ruled over Egypt. And except they came out, ecclesia, they would not have been the church, but they were the congregation, the church, the assembly, the fellowship of the people that came out. And now they were going through the wilderness, and they were going through into the land of promise. What's the church then? The church is the ecclesia. The church is the called out people. The church is the separated people. The church is the assembly of people by redemption, by the blood of the Lamb. They have come out of that wilderness of the world, and they have come out of Egypt. They have come out of the world, and they're going through the wilderness of this world, and they're going to the land of promise. It says over there in verse 38, there is a seed that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which speak unto him. Well, it says with the angel which speak unto him. Have you noticed that Moses, as you look at Moses, number one, his face shone like that of an angel, because we're told that when he came out from the Mount Sinai, that his face was shining. Acts of the Apostles, I'm looking at chapter 6. Acts of the Apostles, we're looking at chapter 6 and the last verse there. And all that sat in the council looking steadfastly on him saw him. I saw his face as it had been the face of what? The face of an angel. And you see that about Moses. To come back to this chapter 7, Acts of the Apostles chapter 7, and I'm reading from verse 38. It says, we speak to him in Mount Sinai, and with our fathers who received the lively oracles to give unto us. Isn't that what the leader in the church does? The pastor in the church, the overseer in the church, the minister in the church, the preacher in the church, that receives the lively oracles of God, the gospel of the Lord, the word of the Lord, the living word of God, the saving word of God, and he gives unto us. Come back to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write. When it says the angel of the church, is that referring to an angel in heaven? The answer is no. It's referring to the leader of the church there. You couldn't write a letter to an angel up in heaven. You couldn't write a letter to somebody here on earth. Why then is such angel? About that, you are the angel of the house fellowship where you are, the leader of the house fellowship where you are, the minister of the house fellowship where you are, of the zone where you are, is the angel of the church in that zone, and then of the district where you are the angel of the district over there, and the group of districts, and then if you're over a whole city, or if you're over a whole region, is the angel of the church in that region, is the angel of the church in that state, or maybe you're a national overseer, we're talking about unto the angel of the church in that nation over there, right? This then is the word the Lord is sending unto the angel of the church. What were they called? Angels, number one. Angels are high, higher than men. And the ministers of God are supposed to be high. We have a high calling, and we have a great calling. And therefore, in the house church in that fellowship, right? You are high, as high as angels. Number two, the angels are holy. And as the angels are holy, the leaders of the churches are supposed to be holy, which means then you are in that zone, you are in that district, you are in that group of districts, or you are in that region, or you are in that state, or you are in that nation. As the person that is leading the people of God there, you are supposed to, number one, to be about the children's church. There's a leader over there too, in the children's church, to the angel of the church among the children, and to the angel of the church among the youth, and to the angel of the church among the women. That means then that you're supposed to be higher than all the other women. You are supposed to be higher than the people that you find there. Number one, you are high, you're heavenly. And it means then that you, as the leader in the church there, you are not earthly minded but heavenly. Thoughts in heaven, your mind in heaven, your heart in heaven, your aspiration, your ambition, everything is of heaven. That's why it's telling us in Colossians chapter 3, are you a leader there to the angel of that church? Are you a leader there to the angel in that house fellowship? Are you a leader there to the angel among those women? Are you a leader there to the angel of the church in the campus? They're right. It's telling us in Colossians chapter 3 verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, high, holy, and heavenly, if ye be risen with Christ, that is by the spiritual resurrection, that you are no more of this earth, but you are heavenly minded. It says, seek those things which are above, where Christ seated on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above. Set your affections on things above. Because you are high, because you are holy, because you are heavenly, like the angels of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. It says, we are risen with Christ, so we are dead. Now there's a spiritual resurrection, and because of that spiritual resurrection, you say to affections and things that are above. And it says, for Christ, who is our life, shall appear. When he shall appear, it says, then ye also shall appear with him in glory, high in glory, holy, therefore glorious, and therefore heavenly as well. Therefore you appear with him in glory. We're coming back to chapter 2 verse 1. To the angel of the church in Ephesus, right? These things are the, says he, that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, and who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. You'll find that in these passages, the Lord used symbolic terms. He used symbolic terms because he had said this was to be signified unto the churches, but he gives the interpretation of the symbols he uses, of the representations that he uses. In that chapter 2 verse 1, he has spoken about the golden candlesticks, and he has spoken also about the seven stars. When you come back to chapter 1 of Revelation chapter 1, and I'm reading from verse 20, it says, the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The seven stars are the leaders of those seven churches. The seven stars are the ministers of those seven churches. And the seven stars are the preachers and the pastors and the shepherds, the overseers of those seven churches. And then you come to chapter 2 verse 1 in the reading from the middle there, the six, it says, he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand. That means he's holding us from the moment that we come to know him as our Savior, as our Lord, and we give ourselves to him, is holding his saints so that we will not fall. You will not fall in Jesus' name. He's holding us faithful. He's holding us so that we can be truthful and faithful to the commission he has given us and to the work he has laid upon our shoulders. And then he says he walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. What are the seven golden candlesticks? The candlesticks are actually to bear the light. They're to carry that the light will shine to everyone around. Come back to chapter 1 verse 20, the latter part of that, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest at the seven churches. The seven churches are supposed to bear the light of the gospel and the truth of the gospel, and we're to enlighten the world around us. As we look at this message, a fundamental church in a pluralistic world, we're looking at three perspectives. Number one, the declared Lordship of Christ, the declared Lordship of Christ. As you look at Jesus Christ as he introduces himself, you can see the declared Lordship of the Lord Jesus. That's number two. We're looking at the demanding life of the church, the demanding life of the church. And then we're looking at number three, which is the declining love of the church, the declining love of the church. Number one is the declared Lordship of Christ, the declared Lordship of Christ. The Lord declared his Lordship, and you will see over here, come back to chapter 2 verse 1 again, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his hand. He holdeth, he has the ability. That's number one. We see his ability. We see his ability. No matter how many of us there are, how many ministers, how many preachers, how many pastors, how many overseers, no matter how many nations we represent or we stand in, is able to hold us. And we look at that, his ability. That talks about his deity. That talks about his sovereignty. That talks about he's so high and exalted. That talks about the very fact that this is God himself, and he's holding us, he's keeping us by his divine ability. He goes on to tell us, he says, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. There we see his activity. Number one is ability, and then number two we see his activity. He tells us that he is able to do all things, and then he walks about. Why is he walking about? He's examining us, he's evaluating us, he's establishing us. As he walks about in all the churches, he's supervising that the church will be like he wants the church to be, like the church will live like he wants us to live, like the church will remain separated from the world like he wants us to separate from the world. And because he has this divine ability, he examines us, he establishes us, and then he evaluates us. He makes us to be the kind of people we ought to be. And I pray that his grace and his work will be efficacious, effective in our lives, even over this weekend, in Jesus' name. And then as he goes about, he's supervising, and then he's sanctifying. Not only supervising and sanctifying, he's also saturating us with his power, with his courage. He gives us backbone, and then we're able to stand. His ability, number one, his activity, number three. And now he says in verse 2, I know thy works. I know thy works. And then you come to verse 7. It says in verse 7, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give. That's his authority. His authority. It tells us that he's in charge of everything. And then he looks at the people who are productive. He looks at the people who are faithful. He looks at the people who are fruitful. He looks at the people who are working according to the word, according to the standard he has given unto us. And he says, I will give. It tells us about his supreme authority. Number one, his ability. Number two is activity, and then number three is authority. As we go on in this, it tells us that he is the one that has this glorious appearance. Come to chapter 1 and see the appearance of the Lord. Chapter 1, in chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 12 and then verse 13. It talks about, why don't we go back to verse 4, verse 11? Saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. Come to verse 12, and I turn to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw the seven golden candlesticks. All that John saw in chapter 1, and the Lord Jesus Christ is speaking up all those details, and he's introducing himself to each of those churches, and to Ephesus in particular. He said, I'm the one holding you, I'm the one keeping you, I'm the one that saved you, I'm the one that secures you, and I'm the one that's able to make you do everything that you're supposed to do. He walks about in the midst of those seven candlesticks, and then verse 13, and in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man. John recognized him. John knew him. He knew him physically, knew him experientially, he knew him spiritually, and he knew him eternally. And you see that when John saw him, he said, that's the Son of Man. I know him. I know him. I knew him when he was here physically. But not only that, I know him experientially. He is my Savior. I know him experientially. He is my sanctifier. I know him experientially. The Lord is my shepherd. I know him experientially. He's the one that fills me with the Holy Ghost. I know him experientially. He's a companion with me. He's staying with me. He's sharing with me. He knew him, and he knew him eternally. He will get out of that Isle of Patmos and then go into heaven eventually, where he continues to know him, and now he will know as he is known as well. He recognized him as the Son of Man, and he said he was clothed with a garment down to his foot, and got about with pants with a golden girdle. He saw him in regal authority. He saw him in royal ability. He saw him in his sovereign activity. And then it goes on to tell us about this Christ. We're looking at Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. And I'm reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 28, the Christ. We're talking about the declared Lordship of Christ. As the Lord Jesus Christ introduced himself, and introduced himself at this time to John. In Matthew chapter 28, I'm reading from verse 18. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me, both in heaven and in earth. We've seen that already. We've seen his authority. We've seen his ability. We've seen his activity. And he says, all power is given unto me. That's why he's able to hold us. That's why he's able to keep us. And he keeps us faithful. He keeps us on our feet. He keeps us in the ministry. And then in verse 19, he says, go ye therefore, because I have all authority, go ye therefore, because I have all power, go ye therefore, because my ability to keep you, to help you in whatever situation you find yourself, because it's unlimited, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Then in verse 20, it says, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Teaching them to observe all things, all things. Not sitting and choosing, not separating, and then I'll teach this, I'll not teach that. This one is for the modern time, and this one is for the archaic time. This one is for the old time, and this one is for the new time. It says, to the end of the world, teaching them all things whatsoever. This one is major, this one is minor, this one is essential, this one is non-essential. This one we can jettison this, this one we have to receive this. It says everything. There is no sifting in the word of God, and there is no choosing and selecting in the word of God, and there is no taking and rejecting in the word of God. It says, as you go, I'm watching you, I'm examining you, I'm evaluating you, and I want to establish you, but I cannot do that if you will keep my commission, keep my commandment intact, as I've given it to you, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you. How often? Always, until when? Until the end of the world. And everybody said, amen. Amen. And so we see what he has given us there. We see the word of God there. And the Lord is saying, that's my ability. And that is who I am. And that is what I will be doing. We're looking at Psalm 18, verse 35. in Psalm 18, verse 35. Psalm 18, verse 35. Here the Lord is still telling us about who he is, and then what he does. He says, thou hast given me the shield of thy salvation. He's holding the seven candlesticks, and because of that, he has given us the shield of his salvation. He has given us the experience of salvation. What salvation? That is being called out of sin. Out of sin into his righteousness. What salvation? Is being called out of our past into a new beginning. What salvation? Is a recreation. It's a recreation. It recreates our spirit. It recreates our heart. It recreates our soul. It recreates our mind. It recreates our personality, so that you'll be able to say, once I was blind, but now I can see. Once I was sinful, but now I am saintly. Once I was unrighteous, but now I am righteous. Once I was a transgressor, but now I'm triumphant. That's a salvation. And he has given us the experience of salvation. He has given us the very joy of salvation. He has given us a shield of salvation, a protective salvation that will protect us from the judgment of God, the judgment to come. And thy right hand has holding me up, and thy gentleness has made me great. Thy gentleness has made me great. This is the ability of the Lord that has brought us into this privilege, this great privilege of being teachers and preachers of the word of God and being ministers in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Isaiah chapter 41. You'll see that this is the promise the Lord has given, and he's telling us that he is the one that holdeth the seven candles, that holdeth the stars, and he walks about in the seven candlesticks. He's walking in the midst of the churches. You'll see that he's fulfilling his promise that he gave unto us in Isaiah chapter 41. Isaiah chapter 41, and we're reading from verse 13. It says, for I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, so that we will not fall, so that we will not fail, so that we will not faint. It says, I'm holding you. I'm holding you. No matter where you are in the ministry, you're up there where the challenges are great. You are down there where the challenges are many. You are on the east side, on the east coast, you're on the west coast. You're in that country where it appears that the time is tough, and the challenge of the day, the challenge of the way is very demanding. It says in verse 13, for I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand. You will not fail. You will not fall. You will not faint in Jesus' name, because the Lord is holding our hand, saying unto me, fear not, I will help thee. Verse 14, fear not thou one Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help you. Number one, I will hold your hand. Number two, I will help you, says the Lord, and the Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Once you know you are saved, once you know you are born again, once you know you are a new creature in Christ, and this change has come upon your life, because if any man be in Christ, is a new creature. Not the old sinful creature anymore. It's not the old crafty creature anymore. It's not the old deceptive creature anymore. It's not the old hypocritical creature anymore. It's not the old pretending creature anymore. It's not the old sinful and selfish creature. Self-centered creature anymore. It's not the old stubborn creature anymore. There is a change. There is a new thing that has taken place, because you know him now as the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. It says in verse 15, behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains and beat them small, and shall make the hills as chaff. That's the promise he has given us. Not whatever the mountain, whatever the challenge, we're up to it, and we're going to stand for the truth the rest of our lives in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen if you're awake. You see, the Lord says he's holding the stars, he's holding the leaders. You are in that house fellowship, the Lord will hold you. I said the Lord will hold you. and then you are in that zone, you are in that district, you are in that old district, whatever, in that city where you are, and then you are ministering, pastor there, overseer there, leader there, preacher there, whatever temptations or trials come against you, you are going to be triumphant in Jesus' name. Christ holds every sheep, and he holds every member of the church, he holds every shepherd and every minister in his fold. He has saved us, he has sanctified us, he has anointed us, he has chosen us, he has appointed us to be his servants, and he does not leave or abandon us after he has commissioned us. Whenever the Lord commissions you to a position, he commissions you to a responsibility, he commissions you to do something significant in his kingdom, he keeps us there. Our security is assured if we remain in his hand while doing his work. That is, we love the work of the Lord, but then we're in fellowship with the Lord of the world. There's some people that make a demarcation between the Lord of the world and the world and the work of the Lord. They're so committed to the work of the Lord, they have no fellowship. They have no fellowship. They have no fellowship with the Lord of the world. But if you are committed to the work of the Lord and you're also committed to the Lord of the world, it will hold us and we will not fail or faint or fall in Jesus' name. He has appointed us to build his church along with him, and when we submit to his control, we are safe and we're secured under his authority. And Christ also walks in the midst of the churches. What does he do as he walks about in the midst of the churches? Number one is to examine and evaluate. Would you know that the Lord is examining what you do? He's walking about in the midst of the churches. When you are in that fellowship, he knows. When you are not there, he knows. When you prepare before you go to that fellowship, he knows. When you don't prepare, he knows. When you prepare before you go to the women meeting, he knows. When you don't prepare, you just go to a women meeting, you are so busy about your, what shall we eat and what shall we drink and where with us shall we be clothed, and then you remember there's women's fellowship today, and then you're rushing there and you are not prepared. He knows. When your mind, when your body is there in that fellowship and your mind is not there, and when it appears activities are going on but there's no unction, function without unction, he knows all about it. That's why he says, I'm walking about in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks as overseer, as pastor and preacher. When you are ready, he knows. When you are not ready, he knows. When you prepare, he knows. When you are not prepared, he knows. When you are doing it half-heartedly, and when you are doing it not with all your heart, and that you are doing deceptively, he knows, because he evaluates and because he examines. Number two is to correct and to convict. To convict and to correct. That when he walks about, he says, is this the best you can do? Is this the best you can offer? Is this what you can give unto the King of Kings and to the Lord of Lords? And when you come under conviction and then you say, Lord, I'm sorry about that, I'm going to correct everything, he convicts and he also corrects. And not only that, number three, he delivers and he defends his people. He says that I'm walking about, he knows that you're in a predicament, you're in a situation that needs a new kind of anointing, a greater power, a greater sustaining power. He says, I'm there to deliver you, I'm there to defend you in times of danger. He's also there to trim our lives, he's there to pour oil, the oil of grace, or the oil of the Spirit, is there to pour it into our lamb's jewel, and is there to purge and to prune so that we can bear more fruit. You'll bear more fruit in Jesus' name. We're looking at John chapter 15. John chapter 15, and we see why the Lord himself is in the midst of the churches, walking about in the midst of the churches. John chapter 15, I'm reading here from verse 1. It says, I'm the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth fruit, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Isn't that one of the reasons why he's walking about in the midst of the churches, in the midst of the golden candlesticks? He sees the ones that are bearing fruit. He sees the ones that are not bearing fruit. You are committed to that local church. You are committed to the church in the local government. And you're supposed to see, just like Jesus Christ, following after the example of the Lord Jesus Christ, and go to all those churches one by one. Evaluate them. Examine them. Strengthen them. secure them. Not only that, convict them, and then correct them, encourage them, establish them, and trim them up, and help them to bear more fruit. But he says, if you are not doing that, you are just, you know, a local government pastor, and you never do that, you never go around, you are not strengthening the church, or maybe you are reaching overseer, you are not bearing fruit. When you took over that region, they were about 2,000, but now they have declined unto 1,700. When you took that local church, they were about 500. Now they are dwindling to about 463. And when you are like that, you are not bearing fruit. You are not an addition. You are not a multiplier. You are not you are not adding any value to that church, either spiritually or numerically. You are just there. You are not bearing fruit. The Lord says, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. We'll bring more fruit in Jesus' name. I said you'll bring forth more fruit in Jesus' name. And so we find, number one, is there was a declared lordship of Christ. I come to point number two now, the demanding life of the church. The demanding life of the church. We come to chapter 2 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 2 verse 1. Chapter 2 verse 1, we read that verse 2 now. I know thy works. I know thy works. I know thy works. Number one, he knows by observation. He knows by observation. He observes everything they did, and because he observed everything, he said, I know, I know. Number two, he knows by supervision. Supervision. Because he's observing them, because he's supervising them. That's how he knew. We didn't know that the Lord observes everything we do. Nothing escapes his observation. He's watching you. Your Christian life, he watches that. Your ministerial life, he watches that. Your faithfulness, he watches that. Everything you do, everywhere you go, he watches that. And he says, I know you. I know your works by observation. Number two, deliberate supervision. Deliberate supervision. I know your works. Number three, by delegation. He knows what's a delicate into your hands. And if you are busy here and there, he knows, he says, I know your words. I know what I delegated to you. I know what I told you to do, and what you are doing is not what I told you to do. There are many people that will leave what was delegated into their hands. And then the Lord is observing them, is supervising them, and he says, is this what was delegated into your hands? We need to come back and see that this is what he has delegated into our hands, and to keep that and to be faithful unto that. Are you in the house fellowship? Keep to that. Are you in that local government? Keep to that. Are you for the women's work? Keep to that. Are you for the children's work? Keep to that. Are you among the youth? Keep to that. Lest it happens to you what happened to this man we're looking at in 1 Kings chapter 20. 1 Kings chapter 20, and I'm reading from verse 39. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 39. And as the king passed by, he cried unto the king, and he said, the servant went out into the midst of the battle, and behold, a man turned aside and brought a man unto me, and said, keep this man. That's a delegation. Keep this man. That was what's delegated into his son. And the Lord knows what he has told you to do. Keep this fellowship and keep this church, local government pastor, keep that local government, regional overseer, keep that region and state overseer, keep the state, national overseer, keep them in the love of God, keep them in the word of God, and keep them in the experience of salvation, keep them ready, prepared to get into heaven. And then if you are, you know, you're a head usher, you're an usher, you're a section leader there, you're a choir master there, he says, keep them, you keep them in the faith and keep them in the ministry, the peculiar ministry and the important fruitful ministry the Lord has given to you. And the delegation, keep this man. If by any means he be missing, then shall thy life be for his life, and the, or else thou shalt pay a talent of silver. A talent of silver was a great amount at that time. Then in verse 40, and as thy servant was busy here and there, he was gone. As thy servant was busy here and there, he was gone. I know thy works by observation. I know thy works by supervision. I know thy works because I knew the delegation. I know what I delegated into your hand. And this servant said, as I was busy here and there, busy here and there, busy here and there, he is gone. Has holiness gone away from the church where you're supposed to be ministering? It's gone. Has the power of the Holy Ghost gone away from the church you're supposed to shepherd and preach it and preach to and teach and develop and grow? The Holy Ghost power is gone. Sensitivity to the word of God, the will of God, is gone there. All that remains is just the superficial thing. The real thing is gone. What are we doing? The Lord is saying, come back to this, because I know thy works. And the king of Israel said unto him, so shall thy judgment be, thou hast decided it. I pray that we'll not be busy here and there on nothing, and then we leave the work that is delegated into our hands in Jesus' name. Let's come back to Revelation chapter 2 verse 1. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how canst thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say the apostles and are not, and hast found them to be liars. I know thy works. Number one, what we say about this church, they were standing up to the task. Standing up to the task. Standing up to the task. The work the Lord had given to, he said, I know your labor. I know your patience. I know your perseverance. How you cannot bear with them that are evil. Number two, they were standing up for the truth. They were standing up for the truth. Number one, they were standing up to the task. Number two, they were standing up for the truth. People will come and introduce themselves as apostles and say, we are part of the ministry too. We can partner with you. We can network with you. We can preach to your congregation as well, because we too were apostles. And they tested them and they saw that they were not real apostles. They were not the apostles of the Lord. And because of that, they rejected them. Isn't this what the Lord is calling us to? Like this angel of the church in Ephesus. Number one, you're standing up for the task. You're standing up for the task. Here is what the Lord has committed into my hand, and I'm standing up to that task. I will not allow the enormity of the world, the demand of the world, to intimidate me. I'm going to face it and do it effectively. Number two, I'm going to stand up for the truth. No matter who comes and he says, we're part of you too, and we want to take part in this labor, we'll say, well, who are you and where do you stand? What do you believe? We're not going to allow people to come in and corrupt the truth of the word of God. This work will not be corrupted in Jesus' name. Number three, they were standing up in the test. They were standing up in the test. Did you see what Jesus Christ said? Look at it in verse 3. And has born. Standing up to the in the test. You are born and has patience. And for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Has labored, has not fainted. Has labored, has not fainted. How is it they had not fainted? Because they joined their preaching with prayer. They joined their prayer with preaching. They were preaching the word of God. They were also praying to the Lord of the work. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 40. They were able to stand up in the test. Isaiah chapter 40, reading from verse 28. Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. That's how this church remained faithful, because they were praying to the Lord of the world. When the going became tough, they became tougher in their mind and tougher in their spirit, and their backbone became stronger to bear the weight and the load of the word. As they went on, then it says, even the youth in verse 30 shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord, they're waiting for upon the Lord, not because of bread and butter, not because of healing and deliverance, not because of material things, not because of personal needs. They were waiting upon the Lord because of the task he has given us. This task is great, and the hill appears high. And we want to be able to have the strength to stand up to the task. We want to be able to have the strength to stand up for the truth. We want to be able to have the strength to stand up in the test. Because of that, they were waiting upon the Lord. And they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and they will not faint. You will not faint in Jesus' name. When your mind is concentrating, focusing on the work of the Lord, and you say, I know that that area, there appears a little bit of weakness. That other area, a bit of negligence. That other area, there's a little bit of timidity. That other area, there's a little, I lack courage in that other area. Because you know your need, because you know your life, because you know your weakness, and because you know your tendencies, you go to the Lord, you say, Lord, I'm waiting on the Lord, not because I'm sick, I want to get healed. I'm waiting on the Lord, not because I'm, you know, I lack this material thing, I want to get a house. I'm waiting on the Lord so that the strength of the Lord, the might of the Lord will be mine. That might and that power, that strength will be yours in Jesus' name. We'll come back to Revelation chapter 2, and I'm reading once again verses 2 and 3. It says, I know thy works, and I know thy labor, and I know thy patience, and I know how thou canst not bear with them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say the apostles and are not, and thou hast borne, and thou hast found them to be liars, and thou hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored, and hast not fainted. What the church in Ephesus did, you'll find the church in Thessalonica, that's what they did. Look at First Thessalonians chapter 1. I'm looking at verse 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, we're looking at verse 3. It says, remember without ceasing your work of faith. Your work of faith, that's the work they did. Any work we do in unbelief will not be commended by the Lord, because whatsoever is not of faith is sin. But it's the work of faith. Because of faith, I step forward. Because of faith, I put my shoulders to the work. Because of faith, because I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, this is what he has delegated into my hands, and this is what he has given me to do. Because I have faith in him, he's not an unjust God that will put a heavier load than I can carry to me. Because of that, I have faith. It's a work of faith, and it's the labor of love. Whatever we do grudgingly, our heart is not there, mind is not there, affection is not there, and the likeness is not there, and we just do it because it's duty, like a Pharisee. We just do it like any of these Jewish people. These are the yoke that is laid upon me, I must do it. But there's no love. There's no love for the Lord of the world. There's no love for the people of God. There's no love for the word of God. But this is duty, this is responsibility, and this is assignment, and these have been delegated to my hands. I don't want to do it, but what can I do? That's what they expect of me. There's no love there. It's when you do it with all your heart, all your soul, all you love it, you are excited about it, you enjoy it, and you're doing your very best and giving your very best. And then it says the patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, in the sight of God and of our Father. And when we do it like that, our labor of love will not be forgotten in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 10. Hebrews chapter 6, we're looking at verse 10. In verse 10 it says, in Hebrews chapter 6, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. Your work and labor of love. When it says work and labor, they mean the same thing, but it's just for emphasis. You see, the load was so heavy that an average person would have abandoned and said, this is too much for me, I cannot go on. But this church of Ephesus, the leader there, the pastor there, the angel of the church in Ephesus, number one, he will not back off. He will not say, well, this is too much, I cannot go on anymore. Not only that, he will not bail out. But he is saying, I think another person can come and take this responsibility is too great for me. Number three, he will not break down under trial. The trial was there. The challenges were there. The difficulties were there. But they will not back off. They will not bail out. and it will not break down. And as you look at the enormity of the work the Lord has committed to us, can we say it's both work and labor, both labor and work? And it appears, you know, as strength is failing you. Instead of saying, I'm going to give up, I don't think I can go on, and then you break down, and then you bail out or you back up, you go back to the Lord. You see, like they did it in Bible days, Moses did, and Joshua did, and David did, and Daniel did, and all these great men of God, the apostles and the ministers and the angels of these various churches, they did everything without backing off or bailing out or breaking down. I too am going to do it. You will do it in Jesus' name. And when you do that, you put all your strength into it, all your mind into it. And then if your consecration of yesterday will not bear the responsibility of today, you bring in more consecration. It's like when you are setting fire. If the wood there is not enough, bring in more food, more fuel, and you bring in more steams. And if the strength you have is not enough, it's not to say lessen my work. No, keep the work as it is, because that is what the Lord has delegated to your hand. Bring in more strength, bring in more courage, and bring in more consecration, and bring in more ability, and bring in more devotedness, more dedication into the work. It is not to lessen the work, it is to increase your strength, it is to increase your commitment, it is to increase your consecration, it is to increase your loyalty, it is to increase your faithfulness, that so that as the work is growing, the faithfulness will grow. As the work is growing, then the earnestness and the loyalty and the devotion and the dedication and the consecration and everything you need to put into the work, everything will grow. It will grow in Jesus' name. That's how they stood in those good olden days, and that's how we're going to keep standing in Jesus' name. Hebrews chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 10. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and your labor of love, which ye have showed toward his name, in that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister. You've done it in the past, you are doing it in the present. And we desire that every one of you, every one of you from House Fellowship to zonal leaders to area leaders, every one of you from pastor to the location to the pastor of the region, every one of you from state overseer to national overseer, every one of you from member to minister, every one of you, do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end. Unto the end, unto the end of your life, the end of your ministry, the end of the age, and the end when Christ will come, that ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Who through faith and patience inherit the promises. You inherit the promises in Jesus' name. Have you noticed? I come back to chapter 2 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 2, I'm reading there from verse 3. It talks about these people that they fainted not. They fainted not. You will not faint in Jesus' name. Look at verse 3. And has borne and has patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Has labored and has not fainted. You'll find that this church actually did what they ought to do. And look at verse 6 now. This thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Notice that the Lord Jesus was commending this church in his observation of the church, in his supervision of the church, and in his evaluating of the church. He says, I find so one good quality here, and the quality is you hate, you detest, you reject the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. There are people that just love everything and whatever it is, from the east to the west, they just love everything going on. From the small church to the big church or the great church, they just love everything. From the church in Africa to the church in Asia, they love whatever is happening there. And from the village to the city, they just love everything. And they come there and they say, we are doing great. Well, we're different. We're not the same. And some people stress this. Some people emphasize that. Some people do not emphasize, but everything is great, everything is good, everything is lovely. They just love everything. But Jesus said no. He said the quality of this church of Ephesus is that there were things they hated, and those were the very things he himself hated too. You're asking yourself, does God hate anything? Does God hate anything? Does Christ hate anything? Being passed on as responsibility in the church. The Lord Jesus said, yes, he said, an example is this, the deeds of the Nicolaitans and the deeds of the doctrines of the Nicolaitans, I hate it. Look at verse 15, verse 16. In verse 15, it tells us, so as thou also, then that word, the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Which thing I hate. He hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans. He hates the doctrines of the Nicolaitans. And there are some people that, you know, they feel that, you know, as you are doing the work of the Lord, just show love. Just show love. Encourage people. Be people friendly. And be, you know, situation friendly. You know, we are at different levels and different understandings. Don't talk as if you hate anything. But the Lord Jesus said the doctrines, those doctrines I hate it. And then he said the deeds, I hate them. And look at this, if you want to know what God hates, there are things he hates, and you better believe that there are things God hates. And if you're a real child of God, he really means that to be rewarded on the final day, there are those things that God hates, you too, you must hate them. Deuteronomy chapter 16. Deuteronomy chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 22. Deuteronomy chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 22. Neither shalt thou set thee up any image which the Lord thy God hateth. Which the Lord thy God hateth. You will not set up any image. An image of Mary, an image of Augustine, an image of Peter, an image of John, an image of Paul, an image of the founder of your church, a picture of the image of your church, the leader of your church, and set it there for people to worship. It says, I hate it. I hate it. There are things that God hates and we don't want to bring into his church. The things that he hates. I'm looking at Proverbs chapter 6, what things the Lord himself hates. And you want to make sure that if those things are there, you want to remove them. You want to take them away. Away from your life, away from the ministry, away from the church. He hates them. I don't like seeing a man in the church. God hates that. Bringing up a man to compete with the Almighty God, with Jesus Christ, the Lord of the church, he hates it. Idolizing a woman in the church, the Lord hates it. That she's non-mereology or whatever logy is there, the Lord hates that. It tells us in Proverbs chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 16. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16. These six things that the Lord hates, yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A proud look, he hates that. And then a lying tongue, he hates that. And hands that shed innocent blood in abortion, he hates that. And heart that deviseth wicked imagination, planning evil, planning, you know, projecting evil, planning to do wicked imagination, he hates that. And then he goes on to say, feet that be sweet, you're only to mischief. Planting evil things in the hearts of people. He hates that. A false witness that speaketh lies. He hates that. And he that sweats discourse among the brethren. He hates that too. He hates that too. And he's saying that the pastor, the leader, the angel of the church in Ephesus, he had this good quality that he hated the thing that Christ hated. And if you also want to have this good quality, you will hate what Christ hates. I'm looking at Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah chapter 61. I'm reading from verse 8. Isaiah chapter 61, I'm reading from verse 8. For I the Lord love judgment, I love justice, I love honesty, I love transparency, I love fair play, I love fairness. It says he loves judgment. I hate robbery for burnt offering. I hate robbery for bunch of it. The people that are rogues and robbers or thieves, and then they go to steal and they're bringing offering to your local church. God says, I hate that. I hate that kind of offering. Reject that. You hate what God hates in the church. Zechariah chapter 8. Zechariah chapter 8. I'm reading from verse 17. Zechariah chapter 8. And we're looking at verse 17. Because we need to hate what he hates. Zechariah chapter 8, verse 17. It says, and let none of you imagine evil in your hearts against his neighbor, and love none no false oath, for all these are things that I hate, says the Lord. False oaths, that is making a kind of vow that is false, consecration that is false, swearing that is false. He says, I hate them, and we need to hate them too. Malachi chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 16. Malachi chapter 2, reading from verse 16. For the Lord God of Israel saith, he hateth putting away, he hateth divorce. And because he hates divorce, that's the reason why, you know, the church is not going to say, well, the situation in which we are now, the condition in which we are now, as you look at all the communities and all the nations of the world, therefore divorce is there. And if we don't allow divorce, then the church is not going to grow. If we're going to demand that there must be restitution because divorce is not permissible, then the church will not grow. The Lord says he hates divorce, he hates putting away. And he tells us in verse 16, says, for the Lord the God of Israel says he hates putting away, that's divorce, for one covered violence with his garment, says the Lord of hosts. And then he goes from there, therefore take heed to your spirits, that she deal not treacherously. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 1, verse 9. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 9. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 9. It tells us, thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. He hates iniquity. And if you are going to be a real child of God, you will love what he loves and you will hate what he hates. We're coming to chapter 2 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 2. And I'm reading from verses 4 and 5. Revelation chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. This brings us to the third point, the declining love of the church. The declining love of the church. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 4, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. You know the word of God, when you bring your gift to the altar, and you remember that your brother has aught against thee. Not even the Lord now, just your brother, just your sister, just your neighbor has aught against thee. Leave your gift there at the altar and go reconcile with your brother and then come back to offer your gift. But it's not just an ordinary member of the church having aught against it. It's the Lord himself. It's the Lord of the harvest. It's the one that has ordained the work. It's the one that has commissioned you to the work. And it says, you're doing my work, but I have something against you. You are up and being, but I have something against you. You are standing up to the task, but I have something against you. It appears you are standing for my truth, but I have something against you. Yes, I know you hate what I hate, but I have something against you. If the Lord has somewhat against you, it will be appropriate for you to stop everything and then go back to the Lord and say, Lord, I need to settle this. I need to settle this. Even if it were a man that has something against you, you want to settle that. If it's your minister that has something against you, I want to settle that. But this is the Lord of the work himself. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. You have left your first love. This is the church in Ephesus, the church of Ephesus, write to them and say, this is what I have against you. You have left your first love. Would you know that this church had been a privileged church, a favored church? Paul the apostle had been there for 3 years ministering, favored church. Apollos had been there ministering for some time, a favored church. Timothy had been there for some time ministering, a favored church. And then church history tells us that John the Beloved, the apostle of love, had been there ministering to them for about 40 years. And now John the Beloved is in the end of Patmos, and the Lord is saying, right back to the church. The things that had been emphasized in that church over and over and over, they have left that. And all behold unto now is just a superficial on the surface. And go tell them they have left their first love. Can I come back? Can we come back to Ephesians? The epistle of Paul to the Ephesians, and see how many times the Lord mentioned love in this particular church. And that he told them that this is the church, and this is what the church ought to look like. I'm looking at chapter 1 verse 15. In chapter 1, verse 15. It says, wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love unto all the saints. That was their first love. They had love to all the saints, all the saints, but now they were leaving that. Look at chapter 2. In chapter 2, verse 4, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins and truth, and we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved, who has now and has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. It talks about the love of God and experience. Look at chapter 3. In chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 17. It says that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye may be rooted and grounded in love. Rooted and grounded in love. May be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height. And to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge. This church started with love. Love towards God and love towards the word of God and love towards one another. Look at chapter 4. In chapter 4, verse 2, it says, without lewdness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. On every chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, they were instructed about love. And that was the very thing they had abandoned. It's mentioned every time, it's taught every time, it's emphasized every time. And it was that thing that was taught and emphasize and they're reaching about in every chapter. That's what they're forgotten. Isn't it like a church that you teach holiness every time and you teach holiness all the time, and yet it is that same holiness that's abandoned, and you teach faithfulness every time and it is that same faithfulness that's abandoned, and they taught love every time and it was that same love they had abandoned. In fact, it says in verse 15 of chapter 4 verse 15, it says in speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. And look at verse 16, there, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. He mentions that every time. And Christ is saying, you will not say you are ignorant about it. The first love towards God, loving God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. You will not say you are ignorant about that, loving the body of Christ, the people I died for, loving the saints. You will not say you are ignorant of this, loving the sinners to the point you are able to bring them back into the fold. Look at chapter 5. In chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 2. It says, walk in love as Christ also has loved us, and he has given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice. It talks about love every time, and it is exactly that they had forgotten and forsaken. We're looking at chapter 6, and as we bring the epistle to a conclusion, chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 23 and verse 24. It says in verse 23, it says, peace be to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with you all and them that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. You see this, that in every chapter, that's exactly what had been emphasized, and yet now it says, come back to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 4. It says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against you. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against you. That love you have heard about so often, that love you've heard about emphasized, stressed every time, and in all its ramifications, in all its height and depth and length and breadth, that love towards God and towards man, you have left that aside. Activity is still there, but there's no affection. The function is there, but the unction is not there. And it says, even though the labor is there, the love is not there. You'll come back to that. Look at verse 5. It says, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent. And he says, and I will come, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent, except thou repent. The Lord Jesus was calling them back to watch that loss. And the Lord Jesus is calling us back, and we're going to everything we have forsaken, everything we have abandoned, we're going to do them again in Jesus' name. Can I have a good amen there?
Amen.
See what the Lord is saying. Three things before we pray. Number one, remember your former devotion. Remember your former devotion. The kind of love you had before, the first love, the exciting love, and the affectionate love, the heart, the passion that you had for me, and for my work, and for my word, and for my people, remember the former devotion. Number two, repent of fatal decline. Repent of fatal decline. They declined in their love. They declined in their commitment. They declined in their devotion. They declined in their consecration. They declined in the manifestation of love towards God and towards the church and towards the things of the Lord. Repent of fatal decline. Number three, refocus on future direction. Refocus on future direction. The Lord was calling them to remember. The Lord was calling them to repent, and the Lord was calling them to refocus. Here we come to this workers' retreat, and the Lord is saying, we need to refocus. We need to now pick up the things, examine your life, evaluate your life, evaluate your ministry, and see the things we have abandoned, and then we come back to those things. And here is the promise of the Lord: he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He that has an ear is now a personal application. Now it's a personal application. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says on churches. They say, to him that overcometh will I give to eat. This is future now. This is prophetic anticipation. Prophetic anticipation. When you come to the Lord this morning, and then you make that personal application, and then you take to mind, you recall in your mind the promise he had made, the prophetic anticipation, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. In the midst of the paradise of God, there is a primary association here. The Lord is saying, you are part of the church, and this message is coming to you. You are a member, you are a minister, you are a preacher, you are a shepherd, you are an overseer in the church, and this is coming to you. Let there be this primary association, that the Lord is not talking to the world over there, he's talking to the church, and he's talking to the leadership of the church. And make a personal application of this to your life, and then you're anticipating the prophetic anticipation, and you're saying, oh Lord, I thank you that the opportunity is still there. I can reset my clock. I can refocus my attention. I can now focus on the future direction, and the Lord will help in this pluralistic society where we are, like with these people in Ephesus. The Lord is calling us, is saying, come back, have an ear to hear, and be sure that you are hearing, be obedient to my word, and the blessings of the Lord will continue, and in this task the work of God will continue in your life, and you'll make a success of this work in Jesus' name. Are you there? I said you'll make a success of the work in Jesus' name. Let's rise up now and talk to the Lord in person. Lord, here, oh Lord, here am I want to be, you want me to be in the work of the Lord. Make a personal application of this to your life, and have this prophetic anticipation, so that you'll be everything the Lord wants you to be in the work of the Lord. Recall everything you have heard and make that a subject of prayer. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer. We're having Christ of ability. He has all the ability. He can hold your hand and he can keep you faithful until that final day. And we're having a God of divine activity. He's going about evaluating, estimating, and he's going about correcting and convicting. He's going about and he's defending and he's delivering. He wants you to be who you ought to be. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. It's a God of divine authority, and he has the authority in your life. And then he says, I know the things you do. He's observing everything, he's supervising everything. He knows what he has delegated into your hand. What are you making of the great work he has committed into your hand? I tell the Lord, I will do what you have called me to do. I will be what you have called me to be. I'll not just be busy here and there, achieving nothing. Tell the Lord, open your mouth and pray. Are you able to stand up to the task? Are you standing up to the truth? You're standing up in the test. Are you being faithful to what He has called you to do? Are you still engaged in what He has told you to be engaged in?